The history of Christianity is part of our history. The history of Christianity is part of our history. Christianity may have been influenced by Roman paganism, by Greek Hellenism, by the various mystery cults and religions that were operating in the world 2,000 years ago. But at the end of the day, it began as a movement within Judaism. Jesus was a Jew. His disciples were Jews. They lived in Israel. And so it's certainly something for us to explore in the same way that our Bible, our Tanakh, we study our national failures and failings in many books of the Bible, the book of Judges, the book of Kings, the prophets like Jeremiah. They all explore things that went wrong in our history. And so in order to learn how to not repeat these mistakes and how to recover if we do, it's not an inappropriate thing for us to study. So by studying, for example, episodes in our history, like the false messianic movement of Shabtai Tzvi in the 17th century, or tonight's discussion of Paul of Tarsus and how he diverted from Judaism, I think for us as a Jewish group, a Jewish crowd, it can be a meaningful exploration. Number two, aside from analyzing different movements in history, I think we can clarify and get clarity on the beliefs and doctrines of Judaism by contrasting it with that which is not Judaism. So again, another reason for maybe embarking in this kind of study is to help us better understand our own faith. Number three, I believe that by exposing some of the fault lines that lie within Christianity, we can help Jews who have embraced Christianity reevaluate that commitment. I've had interactions with numerous Jewish people, many Messianic Jews, from whom this topic was an important catalyst in their return to Judaism. And finally, and this might be the most controversial of my four reasons, I think that while some rabbinic authorities over history, especially in the last 200 years, some rabbinic authorities have taken the position that Christianity might be a valid spiritual path for non-Jews, I think that was taken, a position taken reluctantly. I don't think that any rabbinical sages said that Christianity is a totally valid path for non-Jews and said it enthusiastically. After all, from a Jewish perspective, much of Christianity is simply not true. For example, it may be a valid spiritual path for non-Jews, but at the end of the day, Jesus was not the Messiah of Israel. There's no two ways about that. And so for Christians, there's no requirement that they have correct beliefs about the Messiah of Israel. Within Jewish thought, they're not going to be judged by God if they make a mistake about who the Messiah of Israel is. But still, you can't be happy for people that believe in something that simply is not true. Secondly, the Greek Testament, the Christian scriptures, by us, are not viewed as part of the Bible or as divinely inspired. Number three, the Christian Bible and much of its theology is based upon tremendous misinterpretation of our Bible. And that's rampant. And finally, much of Christianity and the Christian Bible engages in demonizing the Jewish people and at some level is anti-Jewish. Many pronouncements in the Christian Bible are simply not acceptable. And so it may be true at the end of the day that for non-Jews, Christianity and its teachings could be theoretically, potentially, according to some rabbis, an acceptable spiritual path, but I don't think it's one that we can advocate enthusiastically. The truth is that Judaism does envision a universal spiritual path for non-Jews. This spiritual path predated Judaism. So long before there was a Judaism, God had already revealed to Adam and to Noah a path of universal spirituality for the whole world. And from a Jewish perspective, that is the default spiritual path that the world should be embracing. It's known as the Noahide Code. And it's not identical to Christianity. Maimonides wrote in the 12th century that Christianity and Islam are actually preparing the world for the ultimate truth. And this will lead to either the universal embrace of the Noahide path or potentially conversion to Judaism. The prophet Zechariah wrote 2,400 years ago, approximately, about the unfolding of this end game. And he writes, "In those days, 10 men of all the nations of the world will grab hold of the garment of a Jew and saying, 'Let us go with you, for we have heard that God is with you.'" Over the past decade, I've been in touch with a growing number of people on this precise journey. For many of them, understanding how Christianity became a separate religion from Judaism was a significant part of that process. Barry Wilson is a professor here at York University, and in 2008 he published a book, How Jesus Became Christian. The book explores how Christianity became a religion that Jesus would probably not recognize or understand, and that contains anti-Jewish streaks that sparked hatred against generations of Jews. Professor Wilson inscribed his book for me, and he wrote in the inside cover, "This book provides the intellectual backbone in my own spiritual journey out of Anglicanism into Judaism." So we have a stake in this story. So I believe that it is worthy of our study. Now, the conventional wisdom and the official position of virtually all the Christian denominations in the world today, and there are thousands, some people estimate over 30,000 Christian denominations. Basically all of these Christian denominations today, and I would say basically of all Christians over the past at least 1900 years, their conventional wisdom, their official position has been that Jesus of Nazareth founded the Christian church. His biography is related in the four Gospels. The fifth book of the Christian Bible is called the Acts of the Apostles. It purports to tell the continuing story of the Jesus movement after his death through his disciples over the next 30 years. Much of the book of Acts focuses on Paul, who spends most of his time spreading his faith in Jesus among Gentiles in Asia Minor, from Syria to Greece, into Rome and Italy, into what's called modern-day Turkey. And this view, this conventional view, basically sees the spread of Christianity as a straight line going from Jesus to Paul and onward. And it sees Paul as operating in tandem with the other apostles of Jesus who were based in Jerusalem. So basically, what conventional wisdom in the church sees is that you had what we all refer to as Peter and Paul. That Peter is the leader of the Jerusalem group, the Jews based in Jerusalem, and Paul operates in tandem with Peter in the exile, in the diaspora, among Gentiles. Again, if you were to take the pulse of most Christians over the past 1900 years, that's the story they would tell you. However, this story is probably not as simple as this. So let's try to understand this slowly. Acts was written, the book of Acts, by someone named Luke, who actually was supposed to have authored one of the Gospels as well. The four biographies of Jesus, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So the same fellow who authored ostensibly the Gospel of Luke also writes this book of Acts, which again is a history of the Jesus movement from the death of Jesus about for another 30 years. Scholars date this book of Acts from somewhere between 90 to 120 of the Common Era. It's relatively late. Now, of the 27 books in the Christian Bible, 13 of them may have been written by Paul, although scholars are really only certain about 7 of them. So when we're trying to understand Paul tonight, I'm going to restrict myself to what are referred to in the scholarly circles as the undisputed texts, letters of Paul. Now, Paul wrote his letters in the 50s. These genuine letters of Paul are undoubtedly a much more reliable record of what really happened in the first decades after the death of Jesus than Luke's account, which is written 40 to 70 years later. And especially when it comes to understanding Paul himself. Again, let's lay it out. We have Paul's letters, which are written in his lifetime about himself. And then we have Luke's account, Luke's story of basically Paul. The main character in the book of Acts is Paul. But Luke is not Paul. And Luke is writing these stories many years later. I would posit that if you want to get the most accurate understanding of Paul, you want to go to his own letters. And we'll see later tonight why there's many reasons to be questioning the accuracy of the account in the book of Acts. Now, before looking at Luke's own before we look at Paul's own writings, it's important to know a little bit about Paul. So according to all accounts, and this is very critical, Paul never met Jesus. Paul never actually met Jesus. He claims to have originally been violently opposed to the Jesus movement. He claims in his writings, and Luke writes about him in the book of Acts, that Paul violently persecuted the followers of Jesus. Now, these accounts about his original opposition to the Jesus movement are in themselves problematic. They're not so simple. For example, he claims, Paul, about himself, to have been a Pharisee who was a student of Gamaliel. Gamaliel was one of the great chief rabbis at that time, the head of the Sanhedrin. And he claims to have been a student and a follower of Gamaliel. We know, however, at least from the accounts in the book of Acts, that Gamaliel himself did not advocate that the followers of Jesus be persecuted. As a matter of fact, Gamaliel urged his students, leave them alone. Well, leave them alone. And he says, if what they believe in is true, so you can't fight them. If it's not true, their movement will die out. But he doesn't advocate anyone persecute them. Yet Paul, who's claiming to be a disciple of Gamaliel, claims at the same time to be locking them up, throwing into prison, maybe even doing worse to them. Another problem with Paul's account about his own opposition is that he says at one point that he went to pursue and imprison followers of Jesus at the behest of the high priest. Now, at that time, the high priesthood were not Pharisees, they were Sadducees. Pharisees and Sadducees were bitter enemies. So how could he, a follower of Gamaliel and a Pharisee, why would the high priest, a Sadducee, enlist him to do anything? So when you study the accounts that Paul writes about himself and his own opposition to the Jesus movement, there are quite a few holes. And one of the greatest holes, which we're not going to explore now, is why would anyone back then have been interested in killing or imprisoning followers of Jesus? That's not clear at all. What were they doing that was against Jewish law? Again, the ruling of Gamaliel was, don't touch them, don't bother them. Gamaliel says, I see nothing wrong with what they're doing. It's not exactly clear when, but sometime around the year 37 of the Common Era, Paul claims to have had a visionary experience where Jesus appeared to him on his way to lock up Christians in Damascus. The book of Acts has contradictory accounts of what took place in this encounter with Jesus. In the book of Acts, chapter 9, it says that when Jesus appeared to Paul and spoke to him in this vision, the people who were accompanying Paul actually heard Jesus speaking to Paul. They heard the words of Jesus. Later on in the book of Acts, in chapter 22, when the same story is recounted, it says the people who were with Paul didn't hear anything. Now, in Christian analysis, Christian commentaries to their own Bible, they have tremendous debates about how to understand these words. Maybe it's not speaking about hearing Jesus in chapter 22. Maybe it's just understanding the words. But be it as it may, the texts themselves seem to be a little bit at variance. At this point, it's not entirely clear what happens. So if you understand so far, the story is pretty simple. Paul claims to have been a violent oppressor of the Jesus sect. Around the year 37, he claims that Jesus appeared to him in a vision, basically telling him, look, now you're going to be on my side. But then it's not clear what happens. If Paul is now going to follow Jesus, what is he supposed to do? He never met Jesus. He knows nothing about Jesus. He doesn't really know anything that Jesus taught. He has this vision where Jesus says, follow me. So what would make sense? He himself, he claims, has been persecuting the followers of Jesus. He knows where they are. They're all based in Jerusalem. And yet in his own letters, mainly in the letter to the Galatians, Paul claims that he did not go to meet with anyone. He specifically says, he pointedly says, I did not go to Jerusalem to meet with the leaders of the group there. I wonder why he's boasting about this. Does that make any sense? That here he wants to be a follower of Jesus. He knows nothing about him. He knows where the people who had been the followers of Jesus and were with Jesus and heard Jesus' teaching were in Jerusalem. And he says, no, I didn't go to meet with them in Jerusalem. He claims that nothing that he knows about Jesus did he receive from any human being. And he claims that his knowledge about Jesus came strictly from Jesus himself, in ongoing mystical encounters with Jesus. He didn't just have this one encounter on the road to Damascus. Paul claims that he continually received mystical encounters with Jesus where Jesus told him what he was supposed to do and believe. Instead of going to Jerusalem and meeting with the leaders of the Jesus movement, Paul claims instead that he went to the desert of Arabia for a period of time, and then he writes, then after this, he says it wasn't until 3 years later that he finally went to Jerusalem And he only met with two of the leaders of the movement. He met with James and with Peter for a period of 15 days only. He didn't come back to Jerusalem until 14 years later. Now, the book of Acts, and this is going to be a little bit complicated, but let's try to focus in on this. That's the story that Paul tells us in his own letters. The book of Acts portrays the early days of Paul's involvement as a follower of Jesus a little bit differently. There in the book of Acts, we're told that after his mystical experience on the road to Damascus, he proceeds to the city of Damascus, to the house of Ananias. Ananias was a member of the Jesus movement. And there Ananias baptizes Paul. And a short while later, Paul then goes to Jerusalem where he's introduced to all the apostles. Now in Paul's account in Galatians chapter 2, he seems to have very little relationship with the group in Jerusalem. This again is important. Paul seems to present in his letters that he was an independent agent, that the people in Jerusalem, they were the people that dealt with the Jewish community, and he himself was dealing with the Gentiles. He claims that it was Jesus himself that appointed him to be an apostle to the Gentiles, and they didn't really seem to have any other relationship. Paul doesn't seem to say in his own letters that he had to report to them, that they supervised what he was teaching, only that they requested he raise money for the poor, ostensibly for the poor members of the Jerusalem group. That's how Paul presents the story. Again, Paul's presentation is that he doesn't really have much to do with the Jesus followers in Jerusalem. They basically have their route, their field of operation in Israel among Jews. Paul claims that he is operating independently among Gentiles, and he doesn't have much responsibility back to the people in Jerusalem. In Acts, however, again, it's presented differently. There, it seems, Paul is more tethered to the group in Jerusalem. He has to report to them. At one point, they seem to haul him in because they're bothered by things they're hearing about Paul. So there he has more of a responsibility, more of a relationship with the group back in Jerusalem, and he has to basically explain what he's teaching to the Gentiles, and they have to approve of what he's teaching to the Gentiles. Now, the first clue that the development of Christianity was not as smooth sailing as Christians have believed over the past 2,000 years, again, what I've started off saying was that the conventional church wisdom is that it was seamless, that you had Jesus, and then it spread through Paul, and it was one basic movement. The first clue that this was not the case emerges from Paul's letters himself. Now, what would happen is this. Paul would travel to different cities, preaching what he repeatedly refers to as my gospel. He calls it my gospel. Apparently, what would happen is, after he went to these cities and he preached and he taught, other followers of the Jesus movement would show up and they would dispute what Paul had taught. So Paul's teachings were being challenged. Almost wherever he went, he was hounded by these other teachers of the Jesus movement, disputing what he was teaching. And Paul would then write letters. That's why these letters are written, basically. The letters that we have in the Christian Bible written by Paul are often letters to the people he had been teaching. And in these letters, he has to warn his students. Paul is warning his students, don't listen to those people. Don't listen to what those people are teaching you. He calls them teachers of another gospel. Paul is constantly having to defend himself against these other followers of Jesus who are questioning what he teaches and his authority. Paul often seems on the defensive, and he needs to consolidate his hold over the people that he had been teaching. It seems that aside from disputing the contents of what Paul was teaching, these other rival teachers would repeatedly accuse Paul of being a liar. They question his integrity, not just what he was teaching. They question him as a person. They question his integrity. How do we know this? Because throughout his writings, Paul is constantly protesting too much. And Paul is constantly saying, I'm not lying. I'm telling you the truth. I'm not lying. I'm telling you the truth. Now, when you read through the Jewish Bible, you don't have Isaiah or Ezekiel or Jeremiah telling the people, listen, people, I'm not lying to you. I'm telling you the truth. Normally, people that are prophets, they give their prophecy. And Paul is repeatedly having to justify himself and defend himself. So what's clear is that it wasn't smooth sailing. What's very clear is that Paul was not getting an easy ride. Now, who might these religious opponents have been? And why might they have disputed Paul's teachings? He refers to them as rival teachers, and sometimes mockingly as super apostles. He doesn't believe they're super apostles, but he mocks them sarcastically. And he speaks about those super apostles who are coming to confuse you. Now we should repeat that Paul never met Jesus, and Jesus never met Paul for that matter. Let's be clear about this. When you read the writings of Paul, if you read his writings, he never mentions Jesus' place of birth. He never mentions anything about Jesus' parents or his family or his close associates. We know, for example, that Jesus was very closely associated and might have been a student of John the Baptizer. Paul doesn't mention John. He doesn't mention anything about where Jesus lived, where he moved to, where he was located. He doesn't refer to any of Jesus' alleged miracles. When you read the Gospels, the four biographies of Jesus, that's one of the main themes of the Gospels, are the walking on water and healing people and producing meals out of a little loaf of bread. It's going on every Mundik and Donnerstag all over the Gospels. You've got these miracles of Jesus. Paul doesn't cite one miracle. He doesn't relate any of Jesus' teachings. You have famous teachings of Jesus, like the Sermon on the Mount, all the parables of Jesus, all the things Jesus taught. Paul never cites any of them. There's no mention of Jesus' trial. So not only do you have a person who never met Jesus, you have a person in all of his writings, and again, he might have written between 7 and 13 books in the Christian Bible, he doesn't mention literally anything about Jesus whatsoever. He does teach a lot about how he viewed Jesus, how he viewed the significance of Jesus' crucifixion and Jesus' alleged resurrection. So the important thing to understand is that in the writings of Paul, what you are not finding is the religion of Jesus. It's not anything about what Jesus taught. It's a religion about Jesus. That's what you're getting from Paul. Nothing really that tells you who Jesus was, what he taught, what his values were, what he was encouraging people to do. It's basically from Paul's ideas, Paul's insights into how he understood Jesus, specifically what the death of Jesus might have meant and his alleged resurrection. That's all you really get from Paul. And he claims that he receives all of these ideas in mystical visions directly from Jesus. So again, who might have been Paul's opponents? Who might have been these people that were dogging after him and that were following him and that were correcting his teachings and disputing with him. So let's briefly at this point try to understand what the Jesus movement was all about. This is going to be important. We don't know a lot about Jesus, and that's for sure. Because number one, he never wrote anything. It would have been nice if we had a book signed Love Jesus. Nothing from Jesus. There's virtually nothing about Jesus in contemporary historical sources, meaning you have Josephus, you have Roman historians like Tacitus. There's virtually nothing about Jesus in contemporary historical sources. All you really have are the four biographies in the Christian Bible called the four Gospels. Matthew, written about the year 80, Mark, written about the year 70, Luke around the year 90, and John written around the year 100. These biographies are written between 40 and 70 years after Jesus is killed. This crucifixion of Jesus might actually be the one thing we can say with confidence that we know about Jesus. That he lived in Israel 2,000 years ago, and he was crucified by the Romans. That much I think it is safe to say. Now, we don't know much about these people who wrote these four biographies. But one critical fact is clear. These stories about Jesus were written after the letters of Paul. People often don't appreciate this. If anyone opens up a Christian Bible, the first four books are the four Gospels. The first books you read, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Then, later on, you encounter the letters of Paul. And most people think the Gospels were written first. It makes sense. That's a story of Jesus' life. And Paul, who came after Jesus, then Paul writes. No, that's not what happened. Paul wrote in the 50s. Paul wrote his letters in the 50s. Years before the Gospels were written. The open question, we're not going to solve this tonight. I'm just raising it as a question. And this is what scholars make their money on. The open question is whether and to what extent these biographies of Jesus might have been impacted by what Paul wrote. Meaning, is it possible that the writers of these biographies of Jesus were people who had already been influenced by the teachings of Paul? That's something we're not going to settle tonight, but I'm leaving it as a question. So we know that the Romans crucified Jesus. Why? Because Jesus claimed to be the king of Israel. And that's what the Romans placed on the cross beam over the crucifixion stake, over the bar in which he was crucified. It said, Jesus of Nazareth, king of the Jews, claiming to be the king of Israel, was considered by the Romans to be sedition. It was considered to be treason. The Romans did not take lightly any challenges to their rule. The Romans were extremely nervous about insurrections, about revolutions, about people challenging their authority. And if someone comes along and says, I'm the king of the Jews, it's not just someone that wanders around the park at night drooling and speaking like a maniac. They can dismiss that. But here's a person that has a following. Here is a person claiming to be the king of Jews, and he has people that are following him and accepting that. And for the Romans, that's a challenge to their authority. The Romans are saying, no, we're in charge of Palestine. We're in charge of Israel. We're the rulers of this land. And for someone to come along and say, no, I'm the king of the Jews, is a challenge to the Roman authority. And so the Romans crucified him. You should know, by the way, the Romans did not only crucify Jesus, the estimates are they crucified approximately 100,000 Jewish people. They did not crucify people for double parking their camels or for other similar crimes. People were only crucified for committing the kind of crimes that challenged Roman authority. They wanted to make examples of people and have them hanging up for a period of 2, 3, 4 days publicly so that people will get the message, don't mess around with Rome. Our best understanding of Jesus is that he was carrying on the tradition of John the Baptizer. Sometimes people call him John the Baptist, like he was John the Baptist, or, you know, not John the Presbyterian or John the Episcopalian, but John the Baptist. That's not really what he would have been called. In Hebrew, it would have been Yochanan Hamatbil, John the Immerser, or the better term would be John the Baptizer. Jesus was basically, and it seems from the Gospels, a student of John. Jesus goes down to the Jordan River to be immersed in the Jordan by John. And John would go around teaching the kingdom of God is at hand, which means that John was announcing the imminent arrival of the redemption. John was telling people that the Messianic age is about to happen. And the Messianic age included a number of changes in the world order, one of them being that God will be recognized by the entire world as the king. As we say in our prayers three times a day, our last prayer, Aleinu, ends with the verse from Zechariah chapter 14, on that day, God will be one and his name will be one. So when John the Baptizer says the kingdom of God is at hand, what he's saying is, we're about to reach that time in history when the whole world accepts the kingship of God. And that messianic age will include the recognition of God's people, Israel, as his chosen people. As again, Zechariah said before, that in this transformed age, the world is going to embrace the Jew and say, we want to follow you because we know God is with you. And of course, in this age of universal recognition of God, the prophets tell us there'll be universal peace. They'll beat their swords into plowshares, their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not lift up sword against nation. They won't learn any war anymore. So that's what the Jewish people have been looking forward to since the beginning of our history, basically. And that's what John the Baptizer was announcing. And he was saying to do what? What do you do about this? He would say, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. John the Baptizer was saying, you can prepare for and hasten the coming of the redemption by getting your act together, by repenting, by changing, by turning away from your sins and turning toward God. This, by the way, is totally in line with Jewish teaching. Totally in line with Jewish teaching. We as Jews believe, and it's based upon the Bible, that the redemption will come as a response to national revival and repentance of the Jewish people. It says in the 30th chapter of Deuteronomy, in the 59th chapter of Isaiah, that the redemption will come when Israel turns to God entirely, when all of us have our spiritual act together. That's when it will happen. And that's exactly what John the Baptizer was teaching, and it seems to be what Jesus was teaching. Because when you go through the teachings of Jesus, the number one thing he says is the kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of heaven is about to break forth. And Jesus spends his time trying to teach people how to be more faithful to God, how to live properly, to repent if they haven't been doing things properly. That seems to be the simplest understanding of who Jesus was. He urged people to repent and to keep the Torah. And this is a critical point. Jesus repeatedly speaks about the primacy and the need to observe the Torah, consistently telling Jewish people, if you want to do the right thing, keep the Torah, keep the commandments, and live lives of righteousness. His followers, Jesus' followers, were shocked by his crucifixion. It's not what they were expecting. And they basically resorted to hoping that he would return soon to usher in the messianic utopia. So they weren't totally fazed by his death. They recovered by saying, okay, we as Jews believe in the resurrection of the dead. Jesus is going to come back one day and he'll bring about the messianic age. We know that this is exactly what his followers were hoping for. They had a very traditional view of what is supposed to happen. For example, in Luke chapter 24, verse 21, they say, "We were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel." That's what his followers were hoping for. They were hoping that Jesus was going to be the redeemer of Israel. And that wasn't a mysterious term. In Acts chapter 1, verse 6, after Jesus' alleged resurrection, the very first question that he's asked is it at this time that you were restoring the kingdom to Israel? That was the focus of Jesus' Jewish followers. And it didn't happen in his lifetime, and so they were praying and hoping that he'd come back soon and accomplish that mission. But aside from this belief that Jesus was the Messiah, who would soon return to bring about the redemption and conclude his mission, there wasn't really much of a difference between the followers of Jesus and the general normal Jewish community. It's important to understand that. The basic difference between the rest of the Jewish community, the regular Jewish community, standard Jewish community, and this small group who followed Jesus was they thought he was the Messiah. Their idea of the Messiah was the same as the rest of the Jewish community. They just insisted it was Jesus, and even though he was killed, they thought he'd be back to actually fulfill his mission. After the death of Jesus, the movement was led for the next 30 years by Jesus' brother James. Jesus actually had at least four brothers and two sisters. One of his brothers, James, took over the reins of the movement and he led for 30 years. The movement continued to worship in the temple and to bring sacrifices and to observe the rest of the Torah. Don't forget that. That's an important piece of the puzzle. The followers of Jesus, even after he died, continued following the Torah, continued worshiping in the temple, continued bringing sacrifices. James was known, by the way, as someone who was very dedicated to the importance of observing the Torah. He wasn't just a regular good guy. He was called James the Just, Yaakov HaTzadik, you could call him. In Acts 21, verse 20, James observes. He says, all of the Jewish people who believed that Jesus was the Messiah were, in James's words, zealous in their observance of the Torah. He doesn't say that Jesus taught them to stop keeping the Torah. He says now, afterwards, after Jesus was dead already, that the followers of Jesus are still zealous, meaning they're very punctilious and careful in their observance of the Torah. Because this group was based in Jerusalem, they're often referred to as the Jerusalem Church, but the word church is obviously an anachronistic term. In the second century, these Jewish followers of Jesus are referred to as either Nazarenes or Ebionites. And aside from their dedication to Torah observance, so again, this movement of Torah observant people hoping that Jesus would be the Messiah when he returns, continued into the second century, and we know this about the Ebionites and Nazarenes. We know something else about them. We know they had a very low regard for Paul. And they saw Paul as an apostate. So now we're getting a little bit of a handle on who these opponents of Paul might have been. What emerges is that there was a Jesus movement that predated Paul's transformation. These included Jesus' actual disciples, including members of his own family. They knew him intimately. They spent 3 years with Jesus as Jesus was teaching. Virtually every day they spent all day long with Jesus. They came to know him thoroughly, and they were intimately familiar with what he taught and what he represented and who he taught about himself. If you wanted to find anyone on the planet who knew about Jesus, you would go to Jesus' own students and family. You wouldn't go to a person who never met Jesus. All you have from Paul is the claim that Jesus appeared to him. So we now understand who Paul's opponents were. They were people who were associated with the Jerusalem church and were disturbed. Why were they opposing Paul? Because they were disturbed by what he was teaching. So let's examine now, what was it about Paul's teachings that might have gotten these people so upset? One of the most critical things about how Paul saw himself was that he saw himself as the apostle to the Gentiles. He sees that as his personal mission. He claims again that he was appointed to this role by Jesus himself, that he is the apostle to the Gentiles. Now, Paul did not require that these non-Jews observe the Torah. First of all, the Torah itself doesn't require that Gentiles observe the Torah. Gentiles only have to observe the Noahide code. But getting circumcised, keeping kosher, observing the Sabbath, the Jewish holidays, that's not required of Gentiles. What happened is this. It seems that there were people from the Jerusalem group who were coming around and insisting that if you're a non-Jew and you want to be part of the Jesus movement, you've got to convert to Judaism, which means if you're a man, you have to get circumcised, and men and women have to observe all the commandments of the Torah. That seems to have been what was happening. Now, Paul, as you can imagine, who was invested in spreading his message to non-Jews, he realized that to require these non-Jews to get circumcised and observe all the commandments of the Torah was going to be an obstacle and a barrier. So Paul is basically taking the position, no, you can be a follower of Jesus and you don't need to observe the Torah. So Paul disputed the claims of these people that were coming around. Now, there is apparently, and I say apparently, a compromise solution that you find in the book of Acts chapter 15, where James, again, who was a leader of the movement, allegedly ruled that Gentiles coming into the Jesus movement did not need to convert to Judaism and observe all the commandments and get circumcised. All they would have to do is essentially follow the 7 Noahide laws. That would be it. Now, there are many reasons to question whether or not this meeting in Jerusalem where James issued this compromise ever took place. It's not really so clear that it happened. But nonetheless, Paul was bothered by the different standards for Jews and non-Jews. And he might have thought that this disparity would make non-Jews in the movement feel like lesser members. And so it seems that Paul began teaching that Torah observance was not required for anyone, be they Jew or non-Jew. So it wasn't simply that Paul was saying that if you're not Jewish, you can still join the Jesus movement and you don't need to fully convert to Judaism and observe all the commandments of the Torah. What seemed to happen was that Paul was advocating that now, after the death of Jesus, no one has to keep the Torah. Jews and non-Jews, it's no longer required. Now, where do you see this? So I'll just share a few examples. There are many, many examples. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 20, Paul says, to the Jews I became as a Jew, so that I might win the Jews. He's interested in converting people. So he's going to become like a Jew so I might win the Jews. He says, to those under the law, meaning to those who are obligated to follow the Torah, I became as one under the Torah, though not being under the Torah myself. He states here outright, I don't believe I'm required to keep the Torah, but I would do it externally in order to get through to Jewish people. Why? That I might win those under the law. In Romans chapter 10, verse 4, Paul writes, The Messiah is the end of the law. And he writes this numerous times in his writings, that the Messiah is the end of the law. You're no longer under the curse of the law. I mean, he basically writes this repeatedly, negating the importance of the Torah. In Galatians chapter 3, verses 24 and 25, he says the Torah was our tutor. I liken it to training wheels on a bicycle. If you're a little kid and you're learning how to ride a two-wheeler, so it's hard. You can't balance yourself. So you have on the back wheels little training wheels. So that's what Paul is saying. The Torah was our tutor. And by the way, it wasn't a tutor for non-Jews. Non-Jews never had to keep the Torah. So Paul writes here in Galatians, the Torah was our tutor. For what purpose? To lead us to the Messiah. The whole purpose of the Torah from Paul's point of view is to lead us to faith in the Messiah, that, he says, we may be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, meaning now that the Messiah is here, we are no longer under a tutor. You can take your training wheels and throw them in the garbage, as far as Paul is concerned. So it seems that the real problem, it's not that Paul is saying that Gentiles don't have to keep the Torah. That wouldn't be so incredibly controversial. It seems that the real problem was that Paul's real position is that no one needs to keep the Torah. And we see Paul being directly challenged on this in the book of Acts chapter 21, where James says to Paul, "They've been told about you, Paul. They've been told about you that you were teaching all the Jews who are among the Gentiles to forsake Moses," meaning forsake the Torah of Moses, "telling them not to circumcise their children, nor to walk according to the traditions." So it seems that the real charge was that Paul was renouncing the importance and the requirement of keeping the Torah even for Jews. For people who have been students of Jesus and heard throughout their walk with Jesus that you have to keep the Torah, this was an absolute scandal. Now, the truth is, Paul had a particular issue with circumcision. Of all the parts of the Torah that really annoyed him, circumcision was the worst. Possibly because it was such a primal identifier of who a Jew was, and in his mind might drive a wedge between Jews and Gentiles. So Paul teaches in his writings, there is no longer a Jew and no longer a Gentile. We are now all one in the body of the Messiah. And so Paul teaches that circumcision counts for nothing. He tells his listeners, if you're circumcised, the Messiah will benefit you not at all. He even goes so far as to say in Galatians chapter 5, verse 12, that he wished that those people who were getting circumcised, that the knife should slip and they should castrate themselves. Another serious point of departure for Paul from the Jerusalem group was his view of Jesus. All the evidence points to the direction that the original followers of Jesus simply saw him as the Messiah. They certainly did not see him as God or worship him or pray to him. However, Paul seems to view Jesus at least, as some kind of pre-existent divine being. Now, I will say that Paul's writings, because they're extensive, are often very confusing and contradictory. So at times he seems to express the idea that Jesus was divine. At other times, he simply sees Jesus as an elevated being, possibly some kind of angel, but nevertheless subordinate to God. So it's not entirely clear how Jesus is viewed by Paul. He clearly has a very, very elevated view of Jesus, possibly seeing Jesus as God. But what is clear is how Paul's readers understood him. It's one thing to be unclear about what Paul meant, but the proof, as far as I'm concerned, is in the pudding. And Paul's students and Paul's readers, how did they understand Paul? So what we see very clearly is that by the end of the first century, virtually all the followers of Paul's teachings came to worship Jesus as God. That's how they understood Paul. Or possibly, if you want to be generous, how they misunderstood Paul. This, from a Jewish perspective, would be considered idolatry. Another delineating issue is the question of how we can be justified in the eyes of God. John the Baptizer and Jesus took the position that we could be justified in the eyes of God by living righteous lives and repenting in the wake of sin. That seems to be in line with Judaism, in line with what the Torah teaches. That's how we're supposed to try to have a relationship with God, and we can be right in the eyes of God if we follow God's teachings and we repent and turn from them if we break God's teachings. We turn from our sins. In the epistle of James, interesting, James, the brother of Jesus, may have actually authored this epistle in the Christian Bible. So in the epistle of James, and again, we know that James would have been a traditional Jew, he emphasizes in his epistle the primacy of living the good life and being obedient to God and observing the Torah. And he says that we can be justified by the works that we do, by the good deeds that we do. Paul, however, who essentially dispensed with the Torah, for him, faith in Jesus replaces observance of the Torah. So Paul repeatedly teaches against what James taught and against what Jesus taught and against what Judaism teaches, that justification is by faith alone, independently of the works of the Torah, meaning it doesn't matter if you keep the Torah. What depends, from Paul's point of view, is simply, do you believe in Jesus? And the way Paul sees Jesus is that Jesus is a sacrifice that dies as a sin for the, as a sacrifice for the sins of those who will believe in him. Now, Paul basically lays his cards out on the table. In the book of Galatians, chapter 2, verse 21, Paul says, if you could be righteous by keeping the Torah, then Paul says, then Jesus died in vain. So you see from Paul, his view is that we are not able to keep the Torah. If we could, then Jesus did not have to die for us. Paul's convinced that we don't have to keep the Torah because we're not able to keep the Torah. And so Paul sees the death of Jesus as a sacrifice for sin that replaces the sacrifices in the temple. But we mentioned before that the followers of Jesus kept on going to the temple and bringing sacrifices even after the crucifixion of Jesus. Now, this focus on faith in Jesus is what Paul referred to as being in the Messiah. Being in the Messiah. And as far as Paul's concerned, that is what defines who is a part of God's covenant people. Paul teaches that the true Israel is not a biological or genealogical issue, but it's one of faith. So Paul says, those who believe in Jesus are the true Israel. And those who don't believe in Jesus, even though they may have Jewish stock, are not the real Israel. When I was living in Philadelphia, I went to a lecture by a Christian group. The lecture was called, Who is a Jew? And it was a two-part lecture. After the second part, I approached the speaker in private. I didn't want to confront him in public. And I asked him, after the two lectures, I said, let me ask you, am I a Jew? And the lecturer said, no, you're not a Jew. And I said, and why is that? He said, because you don't believe in God. Because for him, Jesus is God, and I don't believe in Jesus. I don't believe in God, and therefore I'm not a Jew. Because the word Jew comes from Yehuda. Yehuda or Yehudi, one who praises God. And as far as he was concerned, I am not someone who acknowledges God. So from Paul's point of view, what comes into play is the very definition of what it means to be a Jew. Now, there are other divergences between Paul and the Jesus movement. These are discussed at length in a wonderful book I'll recommend for those interested in the topic by Professor James Tabor called Paul and Jesus. And Professor Tabor actually discusses a number of other total divergences between what Paul taught and between what Jesus taught. We're not going to go into them tonight. Suffice it to say that based upon the ones that I've discussed, there were enough rejections of the original teachings of Jesus that got him into hot water with the followers of Jesus who were based in Jerusalem. And into the second century, in the eyes of the Ebionites and Nazarenes. So did Paul invent Christianity? It's not clear to me. It's a matter, I believe, of semantics. Some actually insist. Professor Barry Wilson in his book insists that Christianity is a total invention of Jesus, of Paul. It has absolutely nothing to do with Jesus. Other people would say, well, he didn't invent the whole religion out of nothing because there already was a messianic movement centered on Jesus. So others argue that Paul distorted or changed the original movement. But at the end of the day, whether you call Paul the inventor or the transformer, it's academic as far as I'm concerned. Now, Christians will usually leap to the defense of Paul by trying to show that he was faithfully carrying out and carrying on the Jesus tradition. That's the knee-jerk reaction of all Christian apologists. They will try to show that no, every single thing that Paul taught was clearly already taught by Jesus. Now, I wanted to make sure that it wasn't my personal religious bias that led me to this assessment of Paul. And so in order to check my math, what I did was look into the research of Islamic scholars on the same topic. And interestingly, what I found among Islamic scholars was basically the exact same assessment of how they viewed Paul's divergences from Jesus. Now, we know that the Jerusalem church eventually disappeared. So we know that within 200, 250 years, this movement died out. Why did that happen? Number one, they lost their leader. James passed away. He was killed in the year 62 approximately. Number two, Jerusalem was destroyed in the year 70, and with that destruction of Jerusalem, many of the followers of Jesus are killed. So the movement itself is physically decimated. The survivors flee to Transjordan. But they're living in a very, very deflated mood, to say the least. And deflated more so when Jesus ultimately did not return when they were expecting him to return. The expectation in the first century was that Jesus would return within that generation. So by the year 50, 55, after the passing of a generation and Jesus has not returned, this movement gets very, very disheartened. And the final nail in the coffin, the final problem for the Jesus movement, was the dramatic growth of Paul's Gentile Christian church and its ultimate persecution of the Jerusalem-based group or the remnants of that group. What happened into the second century was actually disgraceful and ironic. That Paul, who was the first heretic, when you think about it, Paul, who was the first Christian heretic in his very, very significant divergences from what Judaism taught and from what Jesus himself taught, that Paul basically launches a group that ends up being the persecutor of the original followers of Jesus as heretics. So here the first heretic becomes the decider, essentially, of who the real heretics are. And he turns the tables. So for Paul, the real heretics, not for Paul so much, but really his followers and the people who came after him, they begin to see those Jews who are clinging to the Torah and the observance of the Torah and the traditional Jewish values, they are now seen by the Christian movement as heretics. Today, there's an exploding interest in the historical Jesus, in the history of the Christian church, And with the wide availability of information on the internet, I believe that we may be in for a major reassessment of today's Christianity by members of the church.